17. We tend to stop there, and really verse 18 is still part of the armor. as the song says, put each piece on with prayer. And we're just going to look at this part of the concept of prayer in verse 18. He says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Let's have a word of prayer as we begin, and then we'll begin to look at this passage of Scripture. Father, thank you so much for this time, and thank you for the blessing that we can be here with these, our brethren. We pray, Father, that you would be continuing to work through your word. Give me the grace to speak. Give us each ears to hear, knowing, Father, that the things that we hear we're accountable for. So I pray that you give us the help to take the truths that you have given us, to tremble at your word, and to truly allow your Spirit to examine our hearts, allow your Spirit to correct us, and to make us more like Christ. We thank you for this time and pray your blessing now in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
How many of you are in school? How many of you are students here? Okay, this is the fun time of the year where we begin to write exams, right? Coming up soon, the exams will be written. And then towards the end of those, they'll start to issue you some grades, right? How many of you are good students? How many of you are good students? Okay. How many of you are A students? Ooh. How many of you are B or C students? How many of you are not so well? All right. Well, grades are somewhat of an imperfect way of gauging a person's ability to master a particular subject, but they are the way we use. That's what we use in order to determine how well we've mastered a particular subject. It either tells us that our abilities in maths or social sciences are good, or average, or not so good. Those are the things that the grades kind of tell us. Now, what I'd like us to do this morning, and as we think about this passage in Ephesians chapter 6, I want you to pretend with me that the Lord is your teacher, and he's going to grade you in the area of prayer. How would he grade you? Would he grade you as an A student, a B or a C student, or one that needs a lot of improvement? And I'm sure none of us, only the Lord himself, was a perfect prayer. But how would he look at us? How would he grade us? If he looked at your prayer life today, what kind of a grade would he issue to you? In school, when you're struggling with a subject, there's a number of things that you can do to bring your grade up. You can take extra, I don't know how you do this in your schools here. In our schools, we can do extra credit. We can write an extra paper. We can do a project, and that will help to bolster our grades. Perhaps you could hire a tutor, or if you're really diligent, you could go back and study the materials that you're sluggish on and re-bring yourself back up to speed. Whatever the case is, you can do certain things to help you to bring your grade up. Now, in terms of prayer, we need to simply go back to the instruction manual. We need to look at what the instruction manual says and simply master what he has given us to do by the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, as we look in Ephesians chapter 6, and as I read that passage, you probably were struck by the word all. Did you notice it? He says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. And what we're going to do is we're going to take four classes this morning. We're going to take four classes on prayer. We're going to talk about the fact that proper prayer includes praying at all times, in all ways, with all diligence, and for all saints. And we want to grade ourselves. Or we want to let the Holy Spirit grade us this morning and tell us exactly where do we need to work if we want to improve our grade or our prayer life in these areas. So let's look in verse 18. He says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. First of all, what's it mean to pray always? Does that mean you're supposed to have a 24/7 prayer meeting? Is that what he's talking about when he says praying always? The ESV translates this, pray at all times. Or perhaps we could understand it in the sense of in all occasions. in all situations. That seems to be the thing that is talking about here. Or in other words, we might say, pray whenever it's necessary, whenever the situation demands it, we should be praying. We all normally pray when we're in trouble, okay? When we get a doctor's notice that there's a problem in health, then we pray. When we're getting ready to write an exam, perhaps, we pray, okay? Especially if we didn't study enough, all right? We all tend to pray when we're in trouble. But what this is saying is we should be praying at all times, not just when we're in trouble. Even an atheist has been known to pray when he's in trouble. So that's not saying much, all right? We need to learn to develop the art of prayer, the act of prayer, at all times. It's easy as we are busy to fall into the trap of praying a quick prayer before we eat, a quick prayer before we go to bed, that's our prayer life. Anybody ever, you don't have to raise your hand, but anybody ever fall into that type of a trap? I remember even as when we had young children, we would come up to the church and we would, somebody would be their responsibility to pray, and then we'd drive into the church building and somebody would say, did we pray? And I said, yeah, you did, you know? And sometimes we kind of get that type of an attitude to prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for this time, amen, and we don't even mean it. Used to have one child that would always pray about a two-sentence prayer, and if we were in a hurry, I would call on him to pray because he would pray quickly, okay? But that can be dangerous because sometimes that's all that our prayer then consists of. James Montgomery Boyce said that this meaning here is that all situations in life should draw forth prayer from us. If we're happy, we should express our happiness to God. If we're despondent, we should pray about that. We should pray in work situations. We should pray while on vacation or holiday. We should pray when we are with friends and when we deal with our enemies. There should be no situations in life in which prayers are absent. I had a good friend that used to say he would pray every time the phone rang. Just before he'd answer the phone, he would pray, Lord, help me with this prayer, or help me with this phone call, which I think is a really good habit. We are also to pray always, that is, at all times of the day and sometimes in the night. Paul does not mean that we are to do nothing but pray, of course. We would not get anything else done. Paul did not do that. He means that prayer is to be a natural, consistent part of our lives. It is not to be regulated just to special seasons or special days. We are to be people of prayer. That's what it's talking about. It should be as natural as breathing to us to pray. That's what he means when he says pray at all occasions. I think it's similar to the passage in 1 Thessalonians where he says pray without ceasing. Simplest verse in the Bible, or one of the simplest verses in the Bible, right? Pray without ceasing. It should be consistent. It should be something that is part of your life. A constant state of communion. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. Can anybody... quote 5 and 6 of Proverbs 3. I'll start you. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding in
all your ways.
All your ways. Acknowledge him and he'll direct your paths. Okay? I don't know about you, but I tend to pray when I don't know what to do. When I do know what to do, I don't tend to pray. That's not what Proverbs 3 says. Proverbs 3 says, in all your ways, acknowledge him, and he'll direct your paths. Now, John MacArthur said, it's to live in continuous God consciousness. It's to live in continuous God consciousness. That's the concept of this idea of praying in all situations. Why should we pray? Why should I pray at all times? Now, by the way, does that sound like work to you? Does that sound like an effort to you? Does that sound hard to you? Do you want to get an A? if you want to get an A in maths, you just take your maths book, right? You put it under your pillow, and you sleep on it at night, and all of that knowledge just kind of osmosises into your head, right? I don't think that's a word, but anyway. It just kind of oozes into your head during the night, right? Is that how you study? You don't study that way? Maybe that's why I got F's in my classes. I don't know. No, that's not how you study. You got to sit down and you got to work at it, right?
Yeah.
You think prayer's going to be any different? Prayer's hard work. We're going to talk about this more in the next point, but prayer is hard work. If you want to get, if you want to improve your prayer life, it's going to take hard work. That's all there is to it. So why should I pray at all times? Well, first of all, God desires our attention. He desires us to be in constant connection with Him. Why? Because He loves us. When you have a relationship with somebody, you want to talk with them, right? You want them to talk with you. And God wants to be in communication with us. He loves us like a husband loves his wife and desires her affection in return. Prayer is our affection towards God. Now, one of the things I want us to do, we have to be careful when we take a passage like this, a verse out of in its context, right, like this, it's easy to get into just behaviorism. It's easy to just start saying, you need to do this, you need to do that. Alright? Paul doesn't write that way, does he? Paul always connects his practical teaching with doctrinal teaching earlier in the book, or all, most of the times he does that. Alright? And I want to do that with you as we look at these four aspects of prayer here in Ephesians chapter 6:18. I don't want to just give you a bunch of do's and don'ts. I want you to see why this is important. So I want you to turn back to chapter 1. I won't leave Ephesians, but I will turn back and forth in Ephesians here with you this morning. Ephesians 1, and I want you to notice in verse 22. I taught Ephesians in my church a number of years ago, and I confess that this particular passage was probably one of the favorite passages that I came upon in this whole book. He says in verse 22, and he put all things under his feet and gave God gave him, Christ, to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Now, when you think of a head, what do you think of? What do you think of as far as the relationship to the body? What does the head do? What is the head's purpose? Okay? This isn't a real hard question. Okay. Let's try imagining something. Remove the head and then see what happens to the body. What's going to happen? You're dead. Okay? You're dead. All right? So what does the head do? What's the main thing the head does? The main thing the brain does? Let's limit it to the brain here. What's the main thing the brain does for your body? It controls it. Every part of your body, right? Did you know your heart is controlled by your brain? Did you know your lungs are controlled by your brain? All right? When I do that, my brain told me to do it. Okay, the brain is controlling every single aspect of what I do. So when we think of a head, we think of direction, right? But then there's verse 23, which is a stunning verse. Because it says, he is the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all things. Now what in the world does Paul mean when he says that the body, because he doesn't say, when some people read this, or some commentaries read this, they say it's talking about his fullness. It's not talking about him being full. He says that at the end of the verse, but not in the middle of the verse. It says that the body is his fullness. Now, what's that mean? How can the body, the church, be the fullness of Christ? It's a remarkable phrase. And I think the thought is this. The NIV commentary puts it this way. Christ chose to allow himself to be incomplete without us. Now, we're not talking about his deity here. Let me explain it. He says, Christ chose to allow himself to be incomplete without us because it's a love relationship. We often speak of a man who is incomplete without his wife. She completes me. Does that mean that you only have one arm and she comes along and gives you a second arm? Is that what it's talking about? No. He's a full man. He's a complete man. But she brings fulfillment to him. Right? And so we talk about completion in that sense. She completes me. She complements me. That's the concept of this idea. And I believe that's what Paul's saying here. Jesus Christ is... I want to be careful. But he has created the relationship between himself and the church in such a way that heaven just won't be the same without us. It's an amazing picture. The one who is above all things, who is before all things, who created all things for himself, has created it in such a way that we bring completion to him. That's stunning, folks. Now, how do we do that? Well, let's continue with the imagery here. Okay? Does your body supply the head any help? Okay, what's the head without the body? It's still dead. Okay, what does the body do? Okay, let's pretend that this is a stove. Right? Why did you do that? Your body sent impulses to your brain, which then pulls your hand back. It's a little bit more complicated than that. But that's the basic picture of it. Okay? When I touch this, I am sending impulses up to my head. And my head then takes that information, calculates it, and makes a decision with it. All right? Anybody here that thinks they're a cat? Anybody here that thinks they're a cat? Okay, so let me ask the question a different way. Anybody ever get up at night and not turn the light on when you walk to the bathroom, the toilet? You think you're a cat then? Cats can see in the dark. Okay, I have a cat at home. All right? My cat thinks that I can see it in the dark. So he doesn't move when I'm walking across the room. And all of a sudden you hear this, meow! Okay, because I stepped on him. All right, because I didn't turn the light on. Okay, what's the light do? It sends, I know the eyes are part of the head, but it sends impulses to the brain so that the brain can make decisions about what to do. Okay, instead I try to see with my feet, and that usually is a bad idea. Okay, that's what I'm doing when I pretend to be a cat. All right, I'm trying to see with my feet. The body sends impulses to the brain. The brain takes that information, processes it, and then tells the body to do different things. That's the relationship between us and Christ. Prayer is our sending impulses to Christ, to the head. Christ takes that information, not that he needs the information, he's omniscient. But he takes that information and makes decisions for the church. It's a love relationship, and that's what we need to see with this particular idea. We are in an intimate relationship with the head. When we are taking his word, where he speaks to us, where he directs us, when we are speaking in prayer in response to him, then we are involved in that type of an intimate relationship with each other. So as we bring this first point to a close, do you pray at every occasion, or do you primarily pray when you need help? How would you feel if you are married, if your husband or your wife only spoke to you when they wanted something? How do you feel when your kids do that? We have grandchildren now. They do that. Okay, I want this, I want this, I want this. Okay? Now, that's not the only time they ever speak to us, but how would you feel if that were the only time they ever spoke to you? What grade do you get in the subject of praying at every occasion? Do you send him signals at all times or just when you're hurting him? The body doesn't do that, and neither should we. Okay. Not only should we therefore pray in every situation, but we should pray with all variety. And that goes back to chapter 6, verse 18. He says, praying always with all prayer. And the thought of this phrase, with all prayer, seems to be with all types of prayer. Not one type of prayer, but all types of prayer. again, to quote Boyce, he uses the ACTS acronym, which stands for Adoration, Confession, Thanksgiving, and Supplication, ACTS. What's the difference between adoration and thanksgiving? What is adoration, first of all? To me, to what is adoration speaking of? What is adore? Okay, all right, we see the value in. That's the concept of adoration. Now, let me ask the question, what's the difference between adoring and thanking? What's the difference between adoration and thanksgiving? They're similar, aren't they? They both kind of fall into the praise category, all right? What's the difference between the two? You didn't think I was going to make you think today, did you? Fair Sunday morning, you're supposed to be able to just kind of rest and not, you know. What's the difference between adoration and thanksgiving? Adoration, you're occupied with what? Just God, His person, His glory, His beauty. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. That's adoration, okay? His wonder, His amazement. When I consider your heavens, the work of your hands, what is man? That's adoration. He's just occupied with the person of God. When we talk about thanksgiving, we talk about His gifts, what He gives. So if we can put it this way, adoration is a concentration just on the person, whereas thanksgiving is a concentration on the gifts of God. That would be the difference. Normally we think of thanksgiving more as how it affects me, how it influences me, whereas adoration is just the awe of who God is. Now we should have both, adoration as well as thanksgiving. Confession, we read that in our scripture reading, is what? What's it mean to confess? Homo logeo. What does homo logeo mean? Homo is, we get the word homosexual from, means same. Okay, logeo is speech, logos, the word. So it's to say the same thing. That's the word homo logeo. Say the same thing as whom. Who am I saying? What am I saying? So if we're talking about confession, we're talking about sin, right? And what am I supposed to say? Who am I supposed to say the same thing as about my sin? God. Okay? So God says, when I lie, what does He say about my sin? Lying lips is an abomination to the Lord. So what does God say about my sin? It's an abomination. Now, if I say the same thing, what am I saying about my sin? It's an abomination. Okay, now it's not what I say, though. I say it was her fault. I know I lied, but am I saying the same thing as God says? It was just a little lie. Am I saying the same thing God is saying? You see how we do? What's the opposite of confession, by the way? Excuse or hiding? Isn't that what David said in Psalm 32? I stopped hiding. I acknowledged my transgression. I didn't hide those things from you. That's what we need to see when we talk about confession. Now, our problem with prayer is that generally we only exercise one of those four elements. We talk about adoration, confession, thanksgiving, and supplication. Now, what's supplication? Asking. Okay? And that's the one we tend to concentrate on. We tend to concentrate on the asking part. We tend to ask for this. Lord, I need this. I need health. I need a house. We need land. Okay? And we tend to ask. And we tend to spend all our time in that area. What Paul is saying here is we need all of those things in our prayer. Now, let's go back and let's think about this a little bit. Why should we start our prayer with adoration? Think about the Lord's Prayer. How does the Lord's Prayer start? Our Father who art in heaven, holy is your name, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now give us this day. What does he do? He focuses our attention upon whom as we start the prayer. Where's the focus of the attention? It's on God. It's on God's greatness. It's on God's, where he dwells. It's on his holiness. It's on his kingdom. It's on his will. And only then do we start to pray and ask. You see that? How do we normally pray? Lord, I need this. What happens when I focus my attention upon God? It regulates the way I pray. Because I can answer this question, but I'm not going to. How many of you are selfish? I can answer it. I already know the answer to this one. Okay. We're all selfish. So therefore, how do we pray? James said, the reason you don't get what you ask for is because of what? You're selfish. I'm paraphrasing, but that's the idea. You're selfish. You're asking to consume it on your own lust. And we begin to pray that way when we're naturally, just that's the way we're going to pray. But when I focus my attention upon God, it changes the way I look at things. Remember the book of Isaiah? Chapters 1 through 5, chapter 5 particularly, Isaiah pronounces 6 woes upon the nation of Israel. Woe is you for this. 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 Then he sees the glory of God in chapter 6. It's no longer woe is you. Me. Why? Because he saw God in his glory. You see? It's as we see God in his glory that it will bring us to confession. It's as we see God in his glory that it will cause us to ask for the kingdom's sake instead of for our sake. And that's why it's so critical that we put our emphasis upon the glory of Christ. Otherwise, we will treat God like Father Christmas and give him our shopping list. Now, as I said at the outset, this takes work. Why? Because the flesh is strong. I went away to Kruger Park a couple weeks ago, and Kruger Park messes up my devotional schedule. Every time I go down there, it messes up my devotional schedule. Okay, I don't get the same time in the Word, and I don't get the same time in prayer just because of the schedule that we hold while we're down there. And so I get home and I think, okay, bang, jump right back into my devotions, just like I've always done them. And it is so hard. I don't want to pray. I don't want to read my Bible. I don't want to do this. Why? Because I gave the flesh some strength. And the flesh took advantage of it. It says, oh, you know what, that was fun. Let's just keep doing that. Let's go keep looking at life's levers. That's much more fun than praying. And the flesh is an enemy that is strong and powerful, and if you're going to defeat it, it'll take a lot of work. By the way, the flesh does yield if you keep fighting at it and working at the area of prayer. If you're going to pray, if you're going to lift up your prayer grade, you have to consciously make an effort to fight against the desires of the flesh. And you do that by focusing upon God. Something else that is somewhat implied by this particular verse is that our prayer should not be general, but should be specific. William Hendrickson said, our prayer life should be definite, not just, O Lord, bless all that awaits thy blessing. The person who prays should become acquainted with concrete situations and needs. When you pray for people, okay, please don't just pray for Pastor Mike. Please bless Pastor Mike. Amen. I like what you guys do here with your prayer time. That was really neat. That was encouraging to me to see that. I appreciate the way you pray like that. And I appreciate the way you pray specifically, because that's what prayer should be. All right? learn about one another's needs, learn about one another's struggles, and pray specifically. That's the idea. He also says that this prayer is to be in the Spirit. J.O. Sanders defined this phrase this way. The phrase means that we pray along the same lines, about the same things, and in the same name as the Holy Spirit. True prayer, therefore, rises in the spirit of the Christian from the Spirit who indwells him. Too often, we find ourselves praying with mere physical strength rather than spiritual strength. We need to understand that the task of prayer is a human, superhuman task, and therefore we need the Holy Spirit to focus us and to drive us. True prayer, then, is focused upon what God is doing, not upon what we want Him to do for us. Now, before I bring this to the second point to a close, let me think about this just one step further with you. When you pray, and when you focus on God, sometimes God directs you to do things that go against the flesh. Right? How did Jesus handle that situation? I know Jesus didn't have sinful flesh, but he still had desires, human desires. Remember in Matthew chapter 26, verse 39, he said, he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me." What cup was he talking about? What cup was Jesus asking the Father to remove from him? It's the wrath of God. The cup usually in the scriptures refers to the wrath of God being poured out against sin. Now, the wrath of God was going to be poured out against sin, and where was the sin being found? It was found in Christ. He was asking that cup be removed, that cup be removed from him. Why? Because that was a terribly uncomfortable prospect for our Lord, to be separated from the Father who he had known from eternity. But what's the next phrase? That wasn't part of the will of God, was it? Was it part of the will of God for the cup to be removed? No. It was the will of God for the cup to be poured out in its entirety upon the Lord Jesus Christ so that you and I could be saved. So how does Jesus deal with what we would call disappointment? He says, "Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." And that's how we have to approach God, how we have to approach life. We get a lot of God's direction from this book, right? God tells us his will right here. People go looking for the will of God. Well, here's the will of God. You want to know the will of God? Just read the book. Okay, this is the instruction manual. You want to know what God wants for your life? It's right here. It's either in precept or in principle, but it's all right here for you. But God's will also works itself out through circumstances. And you find that you've got cancer. You find that you've lost a job. You find that you have a relationship that has gone sour because of something somebody else has done to you. Is that part of the will of God?
Yes.
Yeah. So how do I respond? Is it painful? Is it difficult? Is it against what I would want? Sure it is. So how do I respond? "God, what are you doing up there? You don't love me." You probably wouldn't say it that way. Sometimes we think it that way. Instead, what should we do? What should we do? Bow the knee. Say, "Not my will, but your will be done." That's the concept of praying that I believe falls within this category. In Ephesians, you see the same thing. You see how Paul, again, if we turn back to Ephesians chapter 1, it's interesting here as you look at Ephesians chapter 1. We don't have time to develop this. I'd love to teach the whole book today, but it probably wouldn't get done by 12 o'clock, so I won't do that. But if you look at the book of Ephesians, this first chapter deals with our position in Christ. You see that phrase, in him, in the beloved one, in whom, over and over and over through chapter 1, right? It's talking about this glorious position that we have in Christ. Verse 4, he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. You ever stop to just think about the glory of that statement? God, if I could put this in human terms, God having all 6 billion of us, and probably more like 12 billion people in time, in history, having all these billions of people in the world look down and made choice of me to salvation. If that doesn't humble you, if that doesn't fill you with gratitude, then nothing will. That's a glorious truth. Or how about this one in verse 5? Having predestined us to adoption as sons. We're in the process of adopting a little girl right now. And I've never fully understood this verse until we went through this process. Right? I probably still don't fully understand the verse, but I'm understanding it better. Adoption. People enter into a family in one of two ways in a human way. Either by birth or by adoption. By birth, you're genetically connected. By adoption, you're brought in to a family, but you have no genetic connection. Now, biblically, we are brought into the family of God both ways. We're born again by the Word of God. And so we have the divine nature, 2 Peter chapter 1. But we're also adopted. And I always looked at that, and I always thought, well, if we're born again, why would he say we're adopted? That almost seems like a secondary application. Or a secondary consideration. Then we went to work on this little girl to adopt her. And I realized this. Adoption, a person that's being adopted, a child who has been naturally born into a family, essentially has the right to be loved. That's the responsibility of the parents in that situation, to love that child. They are naturally loved because they are naturally born. A child who's adopted has no right to be loved. Parents choose to love that child. That's what God did with us. I had no claim upon the love of God, and yet he chose to love me. Now, we could keep going. I won't keep going because I love this section. I could keep going with it, all right? But he talks about our forgiveness. He talks about our redemption. He talks about the Holy Spirit sealing. He talks about all these different things. And all of these things drive us to worship God because of the incredible God that we are serving. And whether you want to call it adoration or thanksgiving, they both go together in this particular section. At the end of the chapter, Paul prays. And it's very interesting how he prays. Look, starting at verse 15. Therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. Now watch the prayer. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and the revelation and the knowledge of him. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of his glory, of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe according to the working of his mighty power. I'll stop there. Did you see one request for health? Did you see one request for material needs in that chapter? Nothing. It's all spiritual. It's all relational. It's all dealing with coming to a greater knowledge of who he is in experience in our lives. Because really, the material things that we think are so important aren't all that important. But our relationship with Christ is an absolute necessity. You see? And it's interesting, we sometimes criticize the Word of Faith movement with their health and wealth preaching. And then we pray health and wealth. Paul didn't pray health and wealth. Paul prayed for spiritual needs. And when you're focused upon God, and you're adoring him, and you're thanking him, you'll focus on the spiritual things too. That's why adoration has to begin our prayer time. So why should I pray with all types of prayers? Because it's God's program. Is your goal to pray, is your goal in prayer to know and to know God and to know God's will, or just to get what you want? Do you use all types of prayer, or do you limit your prayer to just asking? If I could do it this way, since we're doing this grading, we're going to give you 25% for adoration, 25% for confession, 25% for thanksgiving, and 25% for asking. What would your grade be? Add the numbers up. Do I get 1% for adoration? 5% for thanksgiving? 24.5% for asking? Well, I still don't have a very good grade if that's what I'm doing. Right? So we need to ask with all prayers, on all occasions, and we need to ask with all watchfulness and perseverance. Look in verse 18. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to the end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. There's two words I want to concentrate on with this third point. The first word is the word watchful. We're to be watchful. The word means to be alert, to lie awake, or to remain sleepless. With only one exception, it is always connected with prayer throughout the New Testament. In Luke 21:36, he says, "Watch therefore and pray." 1 Peter 4:7, "The end of all things is at hand. Therefore be serious and watchful in your prayers." Matthew 26:41, "Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation." And then the one passage that is not directly connected with prayer, Hebrews 13:17, "Obey those who rule over you and be submissive, for they watch out for your souls as those who must give account. Let them do so with joy and not with grief, for that would be unprofitable for you." Now, I believe that this last verse, even though it is not directly connected with prayer, gives us a real good understanding of what it means to be watchful in prayer. What are the pastors and leaders of a church doing when they watch for your souls? What's it mean to watch for your souls? You're watching for the moya to fly up from someplace. Is that what it's talking about? What's it mean? Watching for your souls, being alert for your soul, being sleepless for your souls, remaining on guard for your souls. What are they doing?
Praying.
Well, they're praying, but what is their concern?
Soul.
The soul. What's going to attack your soul? Okay, let's change the imagery. You're a shepherd. You're in the middle of the Kruger National Park and you have a flock of sheep. You don't even have to have a flock of sheep. You're just in the middle of the Kruger National Park. What's your attitude going to be? I think I'll lie down here and sleep for a little while.
No.
Anybody going to take a nap in the middle of the Kruger National Park?
No.
Maybe at noon, but not at midnight. Okay? This is how I walk through the Kruger National Park, if I were doing it. Right? That still probably won't help you. But at least you're on guard. When we were there a couple years ago, and we had a tire puncture. It changed the tire in the middle of the park with nobody else around. And there were four of us. It was my wife and I. It was Pastor Cecil and his wife. I had the excuse that I had a bad leg, so I couldn't change the tire at the time. Cecil had to change the tire. Marie was on one door, I was on one door, and Sonny was on one door, and we were looking. That's watchfulness. Now we have a roaring lion that's seeking to devour us. And he's seeking to devour the sheep of this church. He's going to use temptation. He's going to use false teaching. He's going to use all these different types of things. And the pastor's got his hand on the pulse of every single person in this church and sees you starting to look away. There to grab you. That's watchfulness. You see, that's the concept of this idea. Now, how do we do it? Well, one of the ways we do it is by praying. That's why I say, even though this verse isn't directly connected with prayer, I think it involves prayer. So, as we look at this idea, we need not just the pastor, we all, this is addressed to the whole church, we all need to be spiritually alert to what's going on in the world and in our church, and we need to be aware of the dangers to ourselves and to others. The church edifies itself in love, right? It's not just the pastor that edifies the church. So that means we're going to be mutually looking out for one another by prayer. See? Hendrickson said, those who are not alert but listless and indifferent to what is going on in their homes, in the streets, in their city, in the state or in the province, we say, yeah, the province of Haoteng, in their country, in their church, in their denomination, or in the world at large, will have a very restricted prayer life. Homer Kent said, we need to be spiritually alert to see when others or ourselves are in particular danger. Don't be lulled asleep. Recognize the times of greatest danger. Great times of greatest danger in a person's life is where there's change. New job, new family, new house, new situation. Those are the times of greatest danger. That's the time. I gave you the illustration of my devotional life inside the Kruger Park, how it gets messed up. I changed my pattern of life. And I'm in a risk at that point. So I get a new job. I've got new responsibilities. I have to work hard. My prayer life is likely to suffer. My Christian life is likely to suffer. I can't make it to church this week because I've got to work this job. You see what I'm talking about here now? So those are the times to be especially alert for a young person going off to university. It's a change. Be aware. Be alert. Be on guard. Watch out for them. Send them text. Call them. Be with them. That's what it's talking about. And we do that in prayer. Hendrickson brought up another interesting point in this area. He said, those who do not know the will of God because they devote so little time to the study of the Word will fail to harvest the fruits of prayer. Those who do not know the promises cannot be expected to go to the deeps of God's promises in their devotions. In other words, to be spiritually illuminated, we have to know the Scriptures, and without the deep knowledge of the Scriptures, our prayer lives will suffer. So if we find our times in prayer are shallow, check out how your Bible study is, your devotional time is. That's the picture here. Now, he also uses the word in verse 18 that we're to pray with all perseverance. We're to pray with perseveringly. This word means to be patient or continuing. It's the only usage of the actual Greek word in the New Testament, but the thought is found in several passages, including Luke chapter 18, verse 1. And there it says, he spoke this parable to them that men ought always to pray and what? Not to lose heart. That's the idea of perseverance. The widow here pictures the believer who is to not lose heart in her prayer, in our prayers. Don't quit. Don't give up. Keep going like the marathon runner who is running the final couple of kilometers in his race. The problem with praying is that we often don't see immediate results. Okay? I don't know if this is true of you. It's true of me. One of the reasons I struggle with praying is because I don't feel like I'm doing anything. When I'm reading my Bible, I'm increasing my knowledge. When I'm witnessing to somebody, sometimes people respond positively to the gospel. I feel like I'm active, I'm doing something. Prayer is begging God. And it's easy to just kind of, I don't see any results, nothing's happening. I've been praying for my father-in-law to get saved for the last 35 years, and nothing's happened. Forget it. That's the picture of praying and losing heart. It's easy for us to think it's almost a waste of time. We can even justify it with the sovereignty of God and say, well, God's sovereign. Why do I need to pray? He already knows what we need. But Jesus told us to pray and not to lose heart. And we need to persevere in prayer because that's how we will keep ourselves and those with whom we minister safe. Again, as we look at the book of Ephesians, as we consider this picture together, the question I want us to ask ourselves is, do we pray with spiritual alertness, or are our prayers unfocused? Are we more like a sprinter or a marathoner when it comes to prayer? Quick burst of speed, get all convicted about the need of praying, but then we lose heart and stop praying. How would God grade us in this area of watchfulness? Now that leads us to our last point, and that's found again in verse 18, where he says, with all supplication, with perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Now what's he mean by all the saints? We could answer that and say, all the saints. That would be one answer, okay? The problem with that answer is that, do you know all the saints? Did Paul know all the saints, even living in his time when the church was a lot smaller than it is today? Well, I don't think that's what it means. But I do think there's a few things that we can kind of glean from this and apply to ourselves in this area. I think there's three things. And the first thing I think it means is this. All the saints you have access to. All the saints you know. That would obviously include the saints in this room. That would include the saints that you would know in other churches. That would include the saints that you know from work or from school. It might include the people that I know from the United States. It would be people that you know. Secondly, I think that if we connect this with the general context here, it means that I don't pray in general. I've already said this, but I want to restate it. I don't just pray general prayers. I pray as specifically as I can. And thirdly, I think that as we look at this idea, there is a sense, I want to see if I can explain this with a little bit more. There is a sense in which I can pray for saints in circumstances. What do I mean by that? I may not know a person's name that's in a persecuted church. If we talk about people in the Sudan, or we talk about people in India, or some of these places where persecution is going, I don't know any names. I don't know them. I do know what I would feel like if I were in that situation. I do know how I would pray if suddenly it became illegal to hold services here in South Africa, or my family was a danger for the preaching of the gospel. And I know how I would pray in that situation. So therefore, pray in that situation. I'm praying in circumstances for people. I don't know them. I don't know who the person is. I don't know what they're facing. I don't even know what they look like. But I have a pretty good understanding of what they would be going through. We had a scare with cancer here last month. It didn't turn out to be anything. But we thought that Marie had cancer. I had a new understanding of what people who have cancer are going through. I know what Josh and Marta Mack are going through. I can pray for them better now because I understand their circumstances. Okay? In this case, I know their names. But sometimes I just know that there's the same with cancer. I don't know the person, but I can pray for them because I understand a little bit better what it's like to go through that. If you've ever lost a child, you know what a person is dealing with who's lost a child. If you've lost a loved one, you know what a person is dealing with who's lost a loved one. Think along those lines as you pray. Don't pray unconsciously. Pray for the two guys that lost somebody. Pray for them as they feel what they're going through. What's their temptations? What's their difficulties? What's their struggles right now? Pray for them accordingly. Does that make sense? All right. Let's just bring a couple of applications to this and I'll quit. Are we praying for all the saints as Jesus is the head of the church? Are we seeking to pray for the different churches around us? And the different brethren in this area. How's our prayer grade? Now let me give you three encouragements as I quit. Three encouragements to pray. Number one, when we pray, we enter the ministry of Jesus Christ. We enter the ministry of Jesus Christ. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25, it says, therefore he is able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession. Jesus' role in heaven, his primary role in heaven in this age, is praying. He's praying perseveringly. He's praying all types of prayers. He's praying at all occasions, and he is literally praying for all the saints. When I pray in that way, I am a co-laborer with Jesus Christ. I am working with him as he is working. I am supporting the ministry that he is currently involved with. And that's a glorious thing. I can be part of what he's doing, what he's exercising right now. Number two, God doesn't leave us to our own abilities to pray. I said it was hard. I said it was difficult. But he's given us the Holy Spirit of God to help us in our prayers. Romans 8, 26 and 27 says, "Likewise, the Spirit also helps us in our weaknesses. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God." We've already said that praying is hard. We've already said that we battle against the flesh just to pray. And then there's the struggle, the added struggle, that sometimes we just don't know how to pray. You ever been in that situation? Somebody's going through something and you say, "Lord, I don't even know what to say. I don't know what to say here. I don't know whether it would be better for this person to crash or for this person to get out of the situation that they're in." This passage tells us we have a helper. We have an aid. We have one who comes alongside of us. And this word helper has the thought of one who comes alongside to give help, to give aid. And the thought is not that the Holy Spirit is going to take over the job and pray for us. The thought is more of an editor. We pray and he edits our prayers. He brings about a prayer that is according to the will of God. So what's my duty? Just pray. I don't have to know how to pray. I don't know have to know all the things that there is to know how to pray. I've got a helper who's going to help me in my prayer. So just pray. And one last encouragement to you as we conclude. Isaiah chapter 62. I've been reading Isaiah in my devotions here the last couple of months. He says in verse 6 and 7, as he comes to the end of this book, he says, "I have set watchmen on your walls, O Jerusalem. They shall not hold their peace day or night." Now, when you think of a watchman in the Bible, you normally think of one who is rehearsing the word of God and the promises of God before the people. In fact, in verse 10, that's what they do. They take the word of God, they preach it to the people, and they warn them. That's what Ezekiel uses the word. I've made you a watchman. Go and warn the people to turn from their wicked ways. But that's not what Isaiah is talking about here. He says, you who make mention of the Lord, do not keep silent and give him no rest till he establishes, until he makes Jerusalem a praise. You know what the watchman's supposed to do? He's supposed to go before God and say, "God, this is what you've promised to do." And don't give him rest until he does it. So as God said about that erring saint, the one struggling with temptation, the one struggling with sin, that I'm working in you both the will and the work of my good pleasure. Has God said that? Has God said, "I'm going to complete the work in you in the day of Christ Jesus. I've given you the Holy Spirit who will be with you until the day of redemption"? Has God said that to us? Has God said, "I will never leave you nor forsake you. Lo, I'm with you always to the end of the age"? Has God made those promises to us? Rehearse them to God. He wants you to. He wants you to take his word. He wants you to pray it back to him. He wants you to not give him rest until he performs his program in the church. So how's your prayer grade? How's your prayer grade? If you want to improve it, then do two things. Take this verse seriously and ask God for help. Lord, teach us to pray. Now, maybe there's someone here that's never personally trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Maybe you're here as a young person, you come to the church, maybe your parents come, but you've never personally dealt with your sin, repented of your sin, and trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. please talk to one of us afterwards, and we'll be glad to talk to you about that, because that is indeed the most important thing you can do here today. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the time. Thank you for the day that you've given to us. Thank you for the opportunity, Father, to be with these brethren. And help us, Father, we do pray that you'd work in our lives, that our prayer would be more acceptable in your sight. May you lead us, may you direct us, may you guide us. We do confess where we fall down. We confess where we are selfish in our prayers. Help us, Lord. Help us to pray truly in a way that would please you more and more like the Lord Jesus himself prayed, who at every opportunity he escaped to have time with you. Father, let us have a prayer life like that, not mechanical, but truly a living relationship with our Lord. Thank you for this time. May you guide the remainder of our day. We pray in Jesus' name. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor Mike. Church, let us stand together as we close our eyes, and I will bring the benediction. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time. The Church of God say,
Amen.
Amen.
Let us sing together one hymn, then we will shake each other's hands, then the Lord bless us until we see each other again. Remember the message, let's put it into practice, let's apply it in our own lives. Pray and just pray. You have the Holy Spirit. You don't have to worry. Just pray. The Lord bless us all. Thank you, Pastor. Let us sing number 58 together. Jabulani sesing abantwana. Be glad and be joyful. You are the children of God.